set that skills for cares version, and I think care broke through very quickly to move into very well. I just want to point out a couple of key elements in the report that may be useful to people to consider. We are expecting significant new demand for services based on the fact that we will be supporting people who currently pay for themselves to reasonably change. So what we've done is we've estimated that demand. We know that there are resources being made available to council to meet that and new responsibilities for them. So there's a table on page 23. Some more detail on Appendix 1 about how roughly £3.4 million worth of resources will be allocated. In terms of staffing, then we're looking at around £500 million worth of additional staffing resource against those new responsibilities. So that's quite significant in itself. Having said all of that, it still seems fairly clear to me that that the funding to be made available is not equitable to the amount of demand that's expected. It's been a really good job in terms of managing that demand as we move forward. The final area that I wanted to point out is that we have appointed a programme lead, and on appendix 2 we show how the work streams and governance arrangements should work in relation to this programme. There are a number of areas need to be covered and explored in some detail in terms of key changes to the Act, and we've got into that and practices that will bring together groups across council and partners to focus in on those areas and then develop what we need to do. So that's all I wanted to say, that short, we will need to report back on the implementation of the Act, and we will need to monitor the progress.
Okay, thanks Graham for that update. Any questions? Phil?
I suppose I'm trying to see what you have to do to practice for any person contacting us. I don't think we've read newspaper articles and don't mention the daily mail, and that's all. Where people are saying, well, is this the change you should expect? Now you can contact us, appears to be the doctor. What do we do in the sort of separate? Those of these communications to say we just now in place negative health care system in the community, not back to the central advice of the city yesterday. Where would communities go to and where can we process things along with it? But this team of 30 people, what's their sort of script when somebody gets hold of our persons?
That's a really helpful question. But on appendix 2, where we identify the care programme board, there's a number of areas that really need to be developed. There's a significant area around information guidance. And that information guidance isn't just about the kind of person, it's also about how people can take additional support themselves, their rights, all those sorts of things. One of my key reasons for bringing the nomination today, rather than just reading through one of the reports, is that actually we're going to have to find new ways as a council of getting that information out to people. We absolutely need a channel shift in terms of being able to access people to give that sort of support. So yes, people will be entitled to come into the social care system and get them through the mechanisms that we have in place, the world mechanisms for support, but actually an awful lot of this is going to be about people finding information out for themselves as well. Key changes that people really need to know about are things like our responsibilities to provide financial advice and information, so enabling and supporting people to invest their money appropriately, to brand new areas that council to get involved in. Clearly, we need to think about how we ask people to do that, how we get some others to do that, not anymore. So, I think the information guidance is a huge area that's significant to me. We really need to work on that hard. Because, frankly, as a council, we're not really that type of information for people to support themselves and compare our kind of return to the hospital, better earnings from the hospital. Big area of work.
Thank you. Chris, yeah.
Thanks, Jay. I would like to say that sort of back here with the amount of people that's going to involve, imagine again that some kind of people need to be assessing and giving the advice to.
with people who don't live with our staff, because actually it's a very different way that they'll have to actually work and operate in partnership with people. I'm just kind of thinking about how do we do that, and I noticed one of the strands of the government was around workforce a bit, and I think that's something that we need to just kind of maybe take a step back and maybe wonder whether that's maybe to the strategic group, the vision from the strategic group, think about how some of those bits of work and start to address that very different relationship, which does start really with our staff working in a very different way, which is going to be, I think, lots of staff are very much welcome that.
Any other points? just can I just as a set of recommendations for the health wellbeing board from Local Health Watch on page 13 of your paper? Yes.
Yes, sorry. Yeah.
Do you want to just
These are actually these are the same recommendations that were made to obviously the same applies to health and wellbeing board. These aren't necessarily in relation to the health and wellbeing board meeting, it's just a general point that many health and social care meetings people find it difficult to contribute to. Our role as health, which is my role here and the representatives of volunteers we have on the various boards, aren't empowered to give their own view on various issues. So the paperwork, if we're to contribute meaningfully, needs to come out towards the time for us to distribute that to other people and get their feedback rather than just presenting our views as fact.
Just maybe ask Claire to comment on two points in that box. So no other business, I'll close the meeting. Thank you for your attendance and best wishes.